More and more sales pros have chosen to pay for LinkedIn Sales Navigator. So let's get some practical tips and hear about what's new from an expert in this episode of Closing Time. Thanks for tuning into Closing Time, the show for go-to-market leaders. My name is Chip House. I'm CMO at Insightly CRM. And today I'm joined by Mandy McEwen, and she is named a top 24 B2B marketer by LinkedIn. And she's also founder of Mod Girl Marketing. So welcome to the show, Mandy.
Thanks for having me, Chip.
So you heard how I kicked this off. So we're going to drill into Sales Navigator. And, you know, some people are lucky enough to have the company buy it for them. Some sales pros, you know, have maybe bought it for themselves. So getting the most out of it is critical. And so that's what we're going to drill into a bit today. But I know that you believe LinkedIn is a must do, must have, you know, for people in the sales space. So how about LinkedIn Sales Navigator?
Yeah, Sales Navigator is the most powerful B2B prospecting tool right now on the market. It has the most capabilities and data for you to find your ICPs, reach out to the right people, connect with them, engage with them, et cetera. So there's really nothing else like it. And not to mention, it's amazing because it helps you build real relationships. It's not just going to ZoomInfo and getting a list of people and blasting their emails, right? So there's so much to it, but it is by far, in my opinion, the most powerful tool that you could possibly be using right now when it comes to B2B sales.
Cool. I'm interested to learn why that is, and we're going to drill into that. But maybe before we even start, I know there's a few new features that have showed up on LinkedIn. One is the spotlights capabilities. Do you want to drill into that and whatever else comes to mind for new features?
Yeah. So they've had spotlights for a bit, but they keep changing them. So I'm going to back up a little bit though and start with the buyer personas feature. So they just rolled this out this year and it's pretty cool. So essentially what you can do is the moment you log into Sales Navigator, on the right-hand side, you'll see an option to build out 5 buyer personas. And what this does is it allows for you to select the certain search parameters based on your ICP. So for example, I have like sales decision makers, I have marketing decision makers, I have one for SDRs and BDRs. And then what it does is when you go into the bigger search, you can select those buyer personas and then it'll automatically fill it out for you. So you don't have to be putting in the same thing every time. And then from there, you can drill down even further, right? And so that's a new feature that I highly recommend everyone start using. It's pretty amazing and it saves a lot of time.
Yeah, that's super cool.
And then to answer your question on the spotlights, so they keep changing things. And now they have the different features on the advanced side of Sales Nav. So there's like the regular Sales Nav, the Sales Nav Advanced, I think they call it, and then like the Enterprise Sales Nav. So there's multiple versions of Sales Navigator. And obviously like everyone gets you different things. But there's a really cool feature now called the Buyer Intent feature. And this is amazing. So what it does is you can go and take, it's a very similar, same snippet as like the LinkedIn ads snippet and put it on your website. So you take this little code, you put it on the website. And then what it does is when you have these lists built out of your account list, your lead list, it's going to let you know who has the highest buyer intent and the lowest buyer intent based on like, I think it's 180 factors that they're looking at. So looking at who's viewing the LinkedIn company page, who's engaging with the company page, who's engaging or recently connecting with anyone that works for the company, who's viewing the website, right? So there's a variety of factors. And then what they do is they rank them based on highest to lowest buyer intent. So you can focus on those people who are actively doing something with your company, right? They're engaging, they're looking at the website, and you can focus on those first because those are like the lowest hanging fruit. It's pretty awesome.
Yeah, that's gold. I didn't know that existed. Sounds pretty easy to use too.
Yeah, it is. It's pretty awesome. And then the same, they keep tweaking things with the spotlights and even like in the main Sales Nav, I don't even think it's like says spotlights anymore. It's like they keep changing and updating it, but essentially looking at again, who's posting on LinkedIn in the past 30 days. That's one of my favorites. It's been around for a while, but that shows you active users. So when you're building out your lists, what you could do is like you have those buyer personas, then you click lead filters and you scroll down and it'll have your buyer personas. And let's say you click marketing leaders and you check that and it automatically does the parameters for that. And then if you toggle on posted on LinkedIn, that's going to show you those marketing leaders that have posted on LinkedIn in the last 30 days. And then it's going to give you a list. And then you can drill down even further because you don't want lists of like thousands and thousands of people. Ideally, you want lists of hundreds or even fewer than 100 because we're trying to be hyper-focused here and create multiple hyper-targeted lists because it's way easier to keep track of and manage that. But it's awesome because then you can not waste your time on people who don't log into LinkedIn, you know? So you can only focus on those people who are active. So that's probably one of my favorite. And then another one that's pretty cool is the following your company. So the sales teams I train love this one because it's like, okay, so we have these people that fit our criteria. Let's toggle this on, following your company. Well, these people already know we exist. So then I'm going to go to our CRM and look to see if they're in our database. Is anyone talking to them already? Has anyone ever talked to them? You know, so it's like, those are like the lowest hanging fruit. And that's why I love leveraging everything that SalesNav has to offer in these, what we're called, you know, the spotlights. And so those are just a few of them.
No, that's a lot of great stuff there. And I want to drill back into lists here in a little bit, but let's start a little bit higher level. And let's just talk about general outreach, right? I mean, so where should people start with their outreach? You know, do I just want to start engaging with the posts of my prospects? You know, what specific recommendations do you have, Mandy?
Exactly, Chip. You got it. You want to engage ahead of time. So when Val and I were speaking, we were talking about, you know, the rule of let's engage ahead of time before we connect. And this is why I love Sales Navigator, because on LinkedIn.com, you can't really control your feed. You somewhat can because the algorithm kind of learns, you know, what you're doing, what you're liking. But with LinkedIn Sales Nav, everything is controlled by you. So the moment you log on, your feed is only going to show you people on your lead list and companies on your account lists. And so it's really fast for you to go through and just click the little leads button on the SalesNav homepage and then click lead updates. And then it's going to show you all the leads that you have on your lead list that are posting updates like now, right? In the past 24 hours. And you just go through and you scroll through and you're like, I want to engage with that. Cool. Click view. It's all on SalesNav. You don't even have to leave Sales Navigator. View, do I like this post? I do like it. Comment on to the next. And you can go bam, bam, bam down the list. And it is so efficient and fast that you can engage with those people ahead of time. Make sure that they see your engagement. So that is either they like it, they comment back, or you wait a couple days. And then you send a connection request. If you're using SalesNav, I like doing this within Sales Navigator. Everyone's a little different. You're gonna have to figure out what works for you. I like keeping my prospecting in SalesNav and everything else in LinkedIn because they're two different messaging platforms, right? So they don't talk to each other. It's like the LinkedIn.com messaging platform, the Sales Navigator messaging platform. So when you engage, then I like sending a connection request on Sales Navigator and mentioning the post I engage with. Hey Chip, I really enjoyed your post yesterday on XYZ. Also agree with your point about ABC, would be happy to connect here. That's it. So you just mention that content. Maybe they were in a podcast. Maybe it's your podcast episode, Chip, right? Like you're a perfect example of someone like this. Hey, Chip, I just listened to your podcast episode yesterday on ABC. I really enjoyed it. Your guest, you know, Joe Smith was awesome. Would be happy to connect here. So anytime you can pull in content or something that people are involved with, you're going to have a really high probability they're going to say yes and accept your connection request. And that's how you get your foot in the door. It's not, hey, Chip, we have this amazing product that I want to share. Do you have 15 minutes? Right? Like that is not what we're doing. Hard pass.
Right.
You want to just build that genuine relationship as easily as you can without coming across salesy.
So I think I used something similar when I reached out to you the first time, actually, Mandy. So apparently yes. I got it right. So
you did indeed. Good job.
Yeah, thanks. So, I mean, obviously it seems like Sales Navigator can make that outreach more efficient, but you know, you have to spend a little bit of time on each to get it right. Right. So it actually is real and it's kind of personalized. I mean, how long do you think it takes to do that effectively for every single prospect?
Yeah. So good question. So I like, you know, backing up a little bit, it's going to take you a while to set up a while. I mean, you're going to need a few hours to set up Sales Navigator properly in the first place. Like if you're just getting started with it or you want to optimize it. So make sure you have your list built out. And I know we'll talk about it here in a second. But when you have all that built out, you need to be spending like an hour a day on LinkedIn and SalesNav combined. And when it comes to each prospect, that just depends on what's happening with those individuals. Are they posting content? Are they commenting? Like what can you engage with? Because not everyone's going to be posting content. Like there are a lot of lurkers on LinkedIn that are gold. Like I've had tons of people that have been following me for years and I had no idea they even existed because they've never commented or liked my post ever. And then all of a sudden they show up in my inbox. Hey, Mandy, I love your content. I've been following you for years. Let's get on a call. And I close them. Right. So
yeah.
I love the posted on LinkedIn in 30 days feature, but there's also a whole world out there of people who might just be commenting consistently. So they might be active users, they might be liking and engaging, but let's say they rarely post, and those people are still fair game. So you're going to have to think outside the box a little bit more on those people, right? But in a general rule of thumb is if you can spend an hour a day and time block that, put it on your calendar every single day to spend an hour a day engaging, you know, leaving comments, sending connection requests, and using Sales Navigator to its fullest, that's going to get you the furthest. But you need to be organized. So you have multiple lists, you have accounts, you got to figure out what works for you and have a strategic plan of action every single day when you go in there.
So when you're engaging every day on LinkedIn, you're spending an hour. So I might be touching 10 or 20 contacts.
Yeah. At that point. And not necessarily spending an hour engaging, but an hour in general. So what I like to do is like in 15-minute increments. So 15 minutes I'm going to spend engaging with these people. Another 15 minutes, I'm gonna look at my prospects and I'm gonna see what they're doing. If anyone accepted my connection request, and another 15 minutes, I'm gonna focus on sending connection requests to those people that I already engaged with 3 days ago. And most likely they've seen my comments. So now I'm gonna go ahead and send them connection requests. So it's like you break it down by these little buckets of tasks that you need to do, and it just makes it that much more efficient. But you have to be diligent about this and actually do it and be organized. And that's Sales Navigator is awesome because it has a little notes feature next to every account in your account list and next to every individual in your lead list. So you can literally take notes, multiple notes based on what you're doing. So, you know, commented on Chip's posts, you know, whatever the date is, right? 8/11/23, need to send a connection request 8/15. And then you go back, right? Chip mentioned this in his message, next time ask him about this, right? Mm-hmm. So like little things like that you can keep track of in your Sales Navigator notes feature.
Great tips. And I love the kind of the time blocks of 15 minutes. That's, you know, a super helpful tip, I think, for people to get the most out of the time that they spend on the platform. So I do want to pivot to and talking about InMail a little bit, because lots of it has been talked about InMail. I think there's plenty of people that use it wrong. I'll just go out there and say that. It certainly seems that way. And, you know, I think it's because it's used wrong. Often it can be noise to a lot of people, and maybe you don't get, you know, the open rates that you want to get out of it. So, but there is a way to use it in a correct way. So, and I think it's highly tied into what we were just talking about, but it's about being real. It's about being personal. But talk to me about how do you like to use InMail?
Yeah, so I don't actually like InMail at all. So I'm just going to be completely honest, but I'm going to give you some tips on how to use it. But I am going to be completely honest here, Chip. I am not a fan of InMail. And the reason is because it is seen as a cold email, right?
Yeah.
There's a right way and a wrong way to do it. And I'm going to talk about that in a second. But first, I want to say why I don't like it and what I like to do instead. So the reason I don't like InMail is because it just looks like another cold email, and you don't get those people in your network. So I like sending connection requests first, because I'm engaging with people ahead of time. And you can do the same thing when you send InMail, but you're engaging, you're leaving comments, you're liking their posts. And then when you send a connection request, it is more of a personal thing. It's like, hey, I enjoy what you're doing here. I want to connect with you. And then they're in your network, and then they see your updates every time you post, right? But not every time, but when you post content, you can message them. So it's more of a closer kind of relationship versus just sending an InMail, which is basically kind of a glorified cold email. So I just wanted to say that first. Now, if you're going to send InMail, do what I just said, right? Engage with them ahead of time and then keep it short and to the point. So the subject line should be super short, maybe mention the posts, right, that you engaged with. And then the same type of thing. It's like the same concept of I'm going to send a connection request. It's really the same thing with InMail, but it's not just a, hey, would like to connect. You need to have another kind of point of why you're reaching out, right? So just maybe like a quick little sentence. But the key is do not pitch and do not be long and salesy and annoying, because that's how most people get it wrong. And most people get it wrong, to your point, Chip, because they're sending the same message to everyone. That is
one size fits all.
Yeah, that's what everyone's doing. And it's like InMail can work, but you have to personalize it to each individual, and you can't come across annoying and salesy. You need to catch their attention with like, hey, I know that Chip actually did his research on me, because the moment in his very first sentence, he showed me that he did his research on me. And that's why I'm going to pay attention, right? But the only reason I use InMail is if maybe someone didn't accept my connection requests, right? Like maybe someone's not super active on LinkedIn. Maybe their notifications are weird and they didn't see my connection request. Maybe they did. And in 3 weeks, maybe I'll send them an InMail because they didn't see my connection request. Maybe they'll see that, you know? So those are the reasons. Or maybe their privacy settings are really weird and they don't even connect with anyone unless you have their email address, right? Like there's a variety of reasons you could use InMail. And I do sometimes. Or if I forget to if I'm on mobile and I click connect and I'm like, dang it, I clicked the wrong button and I forgot to send the message with it, then I'll send an InMail, you know? But those are the reasons why I don't necessarily like it, is because it's just seen as another way to blast cold messages to people.
Yeah, I think every messaging platform in the world has always been abused by especially salespeople, it seems like, you know?
Yes.
And so definitely, if you're going to send an effective email, whether you're a marketer or a salesperson, it's going to be timely, it's going to be personalized, it's going to be relevant. And so if you are using InMail, it has to have that kind of bar, I would suspect.
Yep, you got it.
Yeah, perfect. So you had talked about, I want to kind of go back to what you talked about, like list building. And I think you talked about maybe, you know, trying to optimize around a certain size of list. Can you remind us what that is, number one? And then number two, how do you keep track of your outreach? You talked about making some notes in Sales Navigator. Do you also make notes in your CRM, or, you know, talk to me more about that.
Definitely. So you definitely want to make notes in your CRM. Salesforce and Sales Nav can talk to each other somewhat. But yeah, you want to be updating them as much as you can, both the Sales Nav front and the CRM. But ideally, salespeople, we all have lists of accounts that we're going after, right? So from an ABM perspective, I have my target accounts, my target companies I want to go after. So I'm going to put those in a list. So you always want to start with the accounts, because we all have accounts we're going after, right? Or we can find companies based on the search parameters. So you build those lists out of the companies. And then from there, you can drill down into your ICPs that work at that those companies. So for example, you have your accounts list. If you go into the, you have your accounts list built out in the account filters, then you go back and you click lead filters. And then you're going to have the option to select one of your buyer personas. So again, I'm going to use the marketing decision makers example. And then from there, you have a list of your accounts that you've already built out. So then I put, okay, my buyer personas, marketing decision makers, and then I'm going to go to my account list of SaaS companies in San Francisco, for example, right? Based on this criteria of, you know, my accounts that I'm going after, or even criteria that you built out that might be a little bit different. But it's, they're already built out. The accounts are already built out and they're named something. So that's an example, right? And maybe I named it SF, you know, SaaS companies. And then you just select those two options, the buyer persona and the account list. And bam, it's going to show you all of those people that fit that criteria of marketing decision makers that work for those companies that you have in that account list. And within two clicks, now you have a highly targeted list of those people. And then you can drill down even further. Okay, now I want to find people who are following our company page. Now I want to find people on those accounts who are posting on LinkedIn, right? So this is how you get really specific and hyper-targeted with LinkedIn. And you, this is just the best way that I like to train salespeople on to begin with, is because everyone has an account list that they're going after. Like, we all have companies we want to work with, we want to land. And when you can build these out and have these different personas at these companies, then you can start engaging with multiple. So I have something called the 5x5x5 rule. It's not mine. A lot of people have this. And it's like, find five companies to start with, five decision makers at those companies, and then leave five comments on their posts. And then you can start engaging with them and sending connection requests. And so this is how I like to start using SalesNav when it comes to list building, because that is the most hyper-targeted way to start doing this and getting results pretty quickly.
Well, I know I learned a ton about using Sales Navigator and best practices today. So any final thoughts, Mandy, as we're running short on time?
Yeah, final thoughts is just get familiarize yourself with Sales Nav, right? It's a beast. This is why I spend weeks and weeks and weeks with each client on Sales Navigator alone, but you're never going to get comfortable with it if you don't use it. So my tip is just go in there, start building out hyper-targeted lists, really familiarize yourself with all the Sales Navigator capabilities. And of course, if you need help, you can reach out to me. I would love to help. But that is my main tip, is just really spend time in there and familiarize yourself with everything that it has to offer, because 90% of sales teams are barely scratching the surface with SalesNav. And it is so powerful, but you have to know how to use it.
Yeah, it really seems like we're, most of us are barely scratching the surface. So thank you so much, Mandy.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
And thanks to all of you for tuning into this episode of Closing Time. Remember to hit click subscribe, tick the bell so you don't miss any episodes, and we'll see you next time.